joint project with Fernando Cirelli. Let me start with some background motivation. I think it's well understood that the recent recession has hit sectors unevenly. Sectors exposed to the virus have suffered more both in the downturn and the recovery. Let me be precise with the following figure. What I've done is plot the behavior of total revenues for the economy from the period 20 Q1 to 21 Q3. The black line is aggregate revenue. Then I take aggregate revenue and divide it between revenue for the contact sector, that's the sector exposed, directly exposed to the virus, versus the non-contact sector. And you can see in the trough of the recession in 20 Q2, aggregate revenues drop about 12 to 13%, but revenues for the contact sector fell by about 22 to 23%, but only about 9% for the non-contact sector. Then if you look at the recovery, by 21 Q3, the non-contact sector is just about fully back to trend. The contact sector is about 5% below trend. Now, it's also understood, but I think not as carefully studied, that there's been a spending shift from exposed contact sector goods to safer substitutes. There's a number of familiar examples. For example, households have shifted from shopping in retail stores to ordering online from Amazon instead of taking airplanes to go to NBER conferences. We've been using Zoom. Instead of going to the movies, we've been at home watching Netflix. Now, why should we care? Well, the substitution from pandemic losers to winners may, first of all, enhance inequality, and it also could enhance the recession depending upon the complementarities across sectors. That is, the losing sector gets hit extra badly, that could spill over and affect the rest of the economy. So what we do in this paper is we disaggregate revenue between contact sector losers, winners, and the non-contact sector. We find, first of all, there's a quantitatively non-trivial substitution of revenue from losers to winners. And we find also, using forecast data, that this reallocation from losers to winners is expected to persist beyond the pandemic. In the second part of the paper, we develop a three-sector New Keynesian model to explain the data. And as I'm going to argue, the model does a pretty decent job of capturing this unequal recession and recovery. And somewhat surprisingly, it also does a good job of capturing inflation, including the recent run-up. So let me begin with the data. So we want to construct revenue measures for three sectors, non-contact and contact divided between winners and losers. We already have the non-contact sector, so we've got to divide contact between winners and losers. And this involves three steps. First of all, we begin with the industry classification into contact versus non-contact sectors developed by Kaplan, Moll, and Violante. Then we include in the contact sector a portion of information technology that provides substitutes, for example, Amazon. Once we have that, we take these firms and we sort them into winners and losers. We do this based on their stock market response to COVID news. And here we look at an indicator of COVID news developed by Steve Davis and co-authors. And we look and see whether or not a firm had an unfavorable or favorable response on the day that the news is released. Then we take the winners and aggregate their revenues, and we take the losers and do the same. And this is what we get. Now, this figure differs from the earlier figure in two ways. First of all, we divide contact sector between winners and losers. And then also beginning in 21 Q3, we use forecast data as opposed to actual data. Those are over the dotted lines. Now, the line for the aggregate revenue and for non-contact revenue is exactly the same as in the first figure. But what differs is the division between losers and winners. And you can see losers at the trough dropped about 32% relative to trend. That's 10% more than the sector average that I showed you earlier. So a rather significant drop relative to the sector mean. On the other side of the coin, winners actually gained in revenue over the crisis, reaching nearly 10% at the trough of the recession and creeping as high as above 15% above trend. And another way to think about it, as winners started out at about 25% of the contact sector at the beginning of the recession and wound up by early 21, accounting for about a third of the overall revenues. So this is the data that we'd like to capture with our model. So now the model. We, as I noted earlier, we start with a simple New Keynesian model with the three sectors corresponding to the sectors that we just measured in the data. We introduce borrowing constraints, and the reason for this is that it introduces a complementarity between these sectors, as noted in an important recent paper by Veronica Guerreri and co-authors. And in our case, the big drop in the COVID losing sector is going to lead to loss of income by workers in this sector and a drop in spending because they're constrained, and that's going to spill over and affect the rest of the economy. Because we would also like to explain the persistence in the gap between the two sectors, we introduce learning by doing. And what this means is that productivity depends upon recent activity levels. So winners have scaled up their activity, they become more efficient. Losers have done just the opposite, lower activity, lesser efficiency. And as I noted, this is going to help us explain the persistence in the gap between winners and losers. And finally, how do we capture the virus? Well, in terms of two shocks that hit the contact sector losers, first is going to be a reduction in the demand for goods from virus-exposed firms, and the second is going to be a reduction in labor supply to these firms as well. And how are we going to find these shocks? We're going to pick the shocks to target the sectoral revenue, the three different sectors, and also the inflation data. And the inflation data in particular is going to help us disentangle demand shocks from supply shocks. So here's the result from taking our model to simulate the pandemic recession. On the left-hand side, we have the sectoral outputs, and on the right-hand side is inflation. And let's start with the left. The dashed lines and dotted lines are the actual data. The solid line is what the model gives us. And first thing to note is we have four series that we're trying to match, three sectors and inflation rates. So four series and only two shocks. So we're not going to match perfectly. But the simple model actually does reasonably well. If you look at the trough in Q2 2020, we capture the unequal decline. That is, losers contract the most, their substitution to the winners. There's actually a spillover effect on the non-contact sector. Non-contact sector drops because the drop in income in paid to workers in the losing sector leads to a reduction in spending in other sectors. So you just see a decline in the non-contact sector. And overall, there's a decline in, the model gives you a decline in aggregate revenue, which is close to the total. And if you look to the right, at the same time inflation dropped, so because the drop in activity was associated with a drop in inflation, the model attributes that to a demand shock. So drop in the demand gave us this unequal sectoral contraction. What happens over time? Well, the virus starts to slowly wane off, the economy improves, but the gap between winners and losers doesn't disappear. And what's happening is over time, the learning by doing is taking over. The enhanced productivity of winners is kind of keeping them afloat. The contraction in productivity by losers is enhancing their decline. Now, up to Q3 21, we've actually been feeding in shocks to the model. After Q3 21, we let the model run. And you see, even though we don't add new shocks, the model explains between 50% and 3/4 of the gap between winners and losers. If you look on the right-hand side, we actually do a pretty good, decent job in explaining inflation. The negative demand shock in the early stages of the pandemic recession accounts for the low inflation. But then what happens is the demand shock is wearing off. There are also supply chain issues which lead to an increase in inflation, and the model attributes that to supply shocks. So we get supply shocks coming in the latter part. And then also, it's not obvious now, but the learning by doing is going to play a role. And I'll get to that in a few slides. But the point is, up through Q3 21, we explain the rise in inflation. And also the rest of the period is a model forecast. And the model forecast predicts a rise and then a slight decline in inflation. But over the year, inflation is elevated. And that's consistent with the kind of forecasts we have now. Now, I'd like to conclude by illustrating what difference the two key features of the model make. First of all, there's the substitution between the goods of losers and winners. So if we shut off that channel, what happens? So the dashed line is the benchmark model with substitution. The solid lines are what happens when we shut off substitution. And what happens? Well, losers don't drop as much, okay, because they're not losing goods to winners. Winners don't win because they're not taking goods from losers without substitution. In fact, they look like the non-contact sector. So what's the point is aggregate demand doesn't drop as much if you shut off the substitution channel. So we don't get as big a fall in aggregate revenue. And we also, we would get higher inflation because we're feeding in the same shocks, but we don't have, now we have demand doesn't fall as much. Okay, so substitution matters for explaining the data. Finally, what about learning by doing? Okay, that's the other key feature of the model. Well, learning by doing takes time. It takes time for productivity to build up in the winning sector and to decline in the losing sector. So for the first year of the pandemic, there's no difference, there's no effect. But then if you looked over time, without learning by doing, the differences between the two sectors evaporate and the model can't explain the persistent gap. But what we think is interesting is without learning by doing, the model also can't explain inflation because actual inflation is up where the dashed line is, but the model without learning by doing gives you lower inflation. So what's going on? Well, beginning in early 21, as the pandemic is wearing off, there's a pickup in demand. Okay. Then what's happening? Well, in the COVID losing sector, there's been a decline in capacity because of learning by doing. There's been less activity, less productivity. So what you're having is a combination of pickup in demand because the pandemic's wearing off and reduction in supply in the COVID losing sector. And that combination is leading to a spurt in inflation. Now, the other thing that's going on is we get some supply shocks in here due to the supply chain pressures. So that's happening as well, but we're controlling for that. It's without the learning by doing, we don't get this big big increase in inflation. And we think, we don't know if one should take this literally, our learning by doing mechanism, but it may be at least a stand-in for what's going on with supply chain pressures. When activity was low, firms weren't keeping up supply chain capacity. They weren't arranging to have ships, planes, trains, truck drivers, and so on. Then demand picks up and it takes time to build up that capacity. And so what do you get? You get a surge in inflation. Maybe we don't get the details exactly right, but in terms of the broad message, I think the story we're telling has a ring of truth for what's going on today.